Good morning, students. How are you all? Welcome to today's class. In the last video, we have discussed about Bohr's atomic model, its merits and demerits. So, like all other atomic models, Bohr's atomic model also has some drawbacks or some limitations. As a result, some other scientists also think about a new atomic model, and the latest atomic model is known as quantum mechanical model of atom. So before studying about that quantum mechanical model of atom, we have to study what are the factors that led to the discovery of quantum mechanical model of atom. Here also there are two main factors which led to the discovery of that quantum mechanical model of atom. They are dual behavior of matter or dual character of matter, and the second one is that Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So first we have to study about these two factors. After that we can go to the quantum mechanical model of atom, that is the latest model of atom. Okay. First, we can discuss about the dual character of matter. Already, we have studied about the dual character of electromagnetic radiation, including our visible light, isn't it? What do you mean by dual character? Two characters. That is, these electromagnetic radiations or visible light, they are exhibiting particle-like character, and at the same time, they are exhibiting wave character. That is what is meant by dual character. That was suggested by Albert Einstein. And in 1924, a scientist known as de Broglie, he suggested that just like this visible light, any material particle like electron, proton, a stone piece or a chalk piece, whatever may be that, any material particle that also exhibiting two characters, that is particle character and wave-like character. So we can generalize that just like visible light, material particles also exhibiting dual character, that is particle character and wave-like character, and that is known as dual character of matter. Okay, and the waves associated with this material particles, they are known as matter waves or de Broglie waves. So a material particle also exhibiting a particle character and wave character. Since they are exhibiting a wave character, there will be a wavelength associated with that matter, isn't it? And de Broglie derived an equation for calculating the wavelength of a wave associated with any matter particle or any material particle. Now we can study how to derive the equation for calculating wavelength of a matter wave. Okay. Now we can study the derivation of de Broglie's equation. That is the equation for calculating the wavelength of a wave associated with any matter or any material particle. Okay. The wavelength of a wave associated with any material particle is calculated by comparing it with a photon. Okay, in the case of a photon, already we have studied that its energy is equal to h nu. In the case of a photon, energy E is equal to h nu according to Planck's quantum theory, that we have studied, isn't it? According to Planck's quantum theory. In the case of a photon, by assuming wave character, we can write its energy is equal to h nu. That we are getting from the Planck's quantum theory, isn't it? Where nu is the frequency and h is Planck's constant. Then if a photon is having a particle character, we can write E is equal to mc square, where m is the mass and c is the velocity. Okay, this was suggested by Albert Einstein. So, if you are assuming a wave character to photon, we can write E is equal to h nu. By assuming particle character to the photon, we can write E is equal to mc square. Both represents the energy of a photon, isn't it? So, we can equate these two equations. So, we can write h nu is equal to mc square. Okay. Then, we know that nu is equal to c by lambda. Nu is equal to c by lambda. So here instead of this nu, we can write c by lambda. So the equation becomes hc by lambda is equal to mc square. Then when we are taking lambda to this side and mc square to this side, how it will come? Hc by mc square equal to lambda. Or the same equation we can write like this. Lambda is equal to h by hc by mc square. Okay, then we can cancel this c. So we will get lambda is equal to h by mc, where h is the Planck's constant, m is the mass of that photon, and c is the velocity. So we can write lambda is equal to h by mc. This is the equation for calculating the wavelength of a photon. Lambda is equal to h by mc. When we are applying this to any material particle, we can replace this c
by v, that is the velocity of that material particle.
That c is the velocity of light, so that c can be replaced by v, that is velocity of that material particle. Okay, so the equation will become lambda is equal to h by mv. Here m represents the mass of that material particle like electron, and v represents its velocity. And we know that the mass into velocity is equal to its momentum, that is represented by p. So we can write lambda is equal to h by p. P is the momentum, that is equal to m into v. Okay, so this is the equation for calculating the wavelength lambda of any material particle like electron, and this equation is known as de Broglie's equation. Okay, now according to this equation, we can see that lambda is inversely proportional to mass. That means as mass increases, lambda decreases. For a particle like electron, where the mass is very very small, lambda will be large. So in such cases, the wave motion is applicable. We can observe the wave motion for small particle. But in the case of any material particle like a ball or iron or a stone piece, the mass is higher. As a result, lambda will be very small, or wavelength will be very small. So in such cases, we cannot observe the wave motion, since its wavelength is very very small. For the materials having higher masses, the wave motion is not applicable. It is because mass is inversely proportional to wavelength. So as the mass becomes higher, the wavelength becomes smaller. So we cannot observe the wave motion of such particles. Okay. The next factor which led to the discovery of quantum mechanical model of atom is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Now we can study what is the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. In the case of moving particle like a car, bus or a ball or planets, they are moving in a definite path. They are moving through a definite path. So we can easily determine its position and their velocity with accuracy. So for heavier objects or for macroscopic objects, we can determine their position and velocity with accuracy. But for microscopic particle like electron or a proton, we cannot determine the position and velocity simultaneously. That is known as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, and the statement is just like this: it is impossible to determine simultaneously the position and momentum of a moving particle like electron with accuracy. It is impossible to determine simultaneously the position and momentum of a moving particle like electron with accuracy. Okay, if you are trying to measure the position with accuracy, its momentum will become less accurate. Like that, if you are trying to measure the momentum with accuracy, its position will become less accurate. Like that, you know, determine both position and momentum with accuracy. Okay. Now, to understand about the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, we can take one example. Suppose we want to determine the position and velocity of a moving particle of electron. This is that electron. Okay. Suppose the electron is coming from this position. So we want to identify the position and velocity of this moving electron. For that, there is a microscope. Okay. Then to identify its position accurately, we have to use a photon of smaller wavelength. Then only we can determine the position of this electron accurately, because electron is very very small particle. So the wavelength also should be very small. The wavelength of the incident radiation should be very small, then only we can identify the position accurately. So here we are using a photon or radiation of smaller wavelength. Okay, that radiation is allowed to fall on this electron. As a result, we can determine the position accurately. But smaller wavelength means, what will be its frequency? Frequency will be higher. That means frequency is indirectly proportional to energy, isn't it? So frequency higher means its energy also will be higher. So this incident radiation is having higher energy. So when this highly energetic incident radiation is hitting on this electron, its energy will change and it will start to move very fastly. And it is deviating from its normal path. Okay, this is the normal path and it is deviating from its normal path. As a result, its velocity we cannot determine accurately. So using a smaller wavelength radiation, we can identify the position, we can determine the position accurately, but at the same time its velocity will change, so we cannot determine the velocity accurately. Okay, so we can tell that both the position and the velocity we cannot determine accurately for a moving particle like electron. Understood that? Next, we can study the mathematical expression for Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Already we studied Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, that is, it is impossible to determine simultaneously the position and the momentum of a moving particle like electron with accuracy. Okay, that means if we can determine the position correctly, the momentum will be incorrect. And if the momentum is correct, the position will be incorrect. Okay, so delta x represents uncertainty in position, that means the inaccuracy in position, and delta p represents uncertainty in momentum, that is inaccuracy in momentum. And according to Heisenberg's principle, we know that if uncertainty in position is more, uncertainty in momentum will be less. And if uncertainty in position is less, the uncertainty in momentum will be more. So we can tell that these two are inversely proportional to each other. So we can write like this: delta x is inversely proportional to delta p. And to change this proportionality sign, we have to multiply with a constant. So we can write delta x is equal to h by 4 pi into 1 by delta p. So here this is the constant, h by 4 pi. Okay, so we can write delta x is equal to h by 4 pi into 1 by delta p. Then when we are taking this delta p to this opposite side, how it will come? Delta x into delta p is equal to h by 4 pi. This is known as the mathematical expression for Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Okay, now instead of writing this delta p, we know that it is momentum, p represents momentum. So instead of delta p, how can we write delta x into delta m into v is equal to h by 4 pi. Momentum is the product of mass and velocity. So instead of delta p, we can write delta mv. And here we are discussing about a electron. We are discussing about electron. So for a particular electron, mass remains constant. So we can take mass to outside. So we can write delta x into m into delta v, because m is constant, velocity only changing. So we can write delta x into m delta v equal to h by 4 pi. Okay. Since here m is a constant, we can take m to the opposite side. So we can write delta x into delta v is equal to h by 4 pi into m. This equation changes to this. Okay. So from this equation, we can understand that the product of uncertainty in position and velocity is inversely proportional to mass of the particle. Mass of the material particle. Okay. So if a particular object is having mass equal to 1 milligram, that we can write it as equal to 10 raised to minus 6 kilogram. So when we are substituting this value for m and substituting all other values, that is the value of h and 4 and that of pi, we will get the answer equal to 10 raised to minus 28 meter square per second. So for an object having mass equal to 1 milligram, the product of uncertainty in position and velocity is a very, very small value. So for such objects, this uncertainty in position and momentum is insignificant. That means we can determine their position and momentum accurately. Okay. Simultaneously, we can determine their position and momentum for heavier object. For microscopic object like electrons, whose mass is very, very small, so for such particles only the product have a significant value. So for such particles only this Heisenberg's uncertainty principle is applicable. Okay. So according to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, Bohr's concept of fixed circular path with definite position and momentum of the electron have been replaced by stating that electron has the probability of having a given position and momentum. Okay, so according to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, we cannot predict that electron can be seen in a fixed circular path around the nucleus. We can tell only there is a possibility of finding the electron. That is the basis of quantum mechanical model of atom.
Only this much for today. In the next class, we can discuss about the quantum mechanical model of atom.